Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless God's holy name. Shall we stand as we prepare now for worship?
Thank you. His services will be on this Tuesday at 10 a.m. here at the church. We're also asking that you keep the family of Odetta Lockwood in prayer.
Yes.
Her service will be on Saturday at the Ted Meyer Funeral Home, and that'll be in Ventura. We're also asking that you keep Sister Grady in prayer. She is in very serious condition. She's in UCLA at their ICU, and she had a tracheotomy done on Friday. On page 14 of the bulletin, there's a list of people to pray for. And on page 12, Pastor will remind us of the special prayers that we are to make. God is a prayer answering God.
Yes, yes.
And for those who truly believe in prayer, I'm going to ask that you focus your mind on Jesus and keep our brothers and sisters in prayer, because it's only a blessing that you and I are not on that list.
Amen.
Let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, we come this moment first acknowledging that you are God and God all by yourself. Master, you are the great I am. You are the first and the last. You are the beginning and the end. You are the author and finisher of our faith. You are God.
Yes.
Master, we come into your divine presence, Lord, asking that you would forgive us of our sins. Father, we realize we have failed you by thought, word, and deed. Father, we realize we have not kept what you asked us to do, but did everything contrary to your will. So, Lord, we ask that you would look deep into the recesses of our being, and if you find anything that's unacceptable in the name of Jesus, please remove it right now. But, Father, we want to have a closer walk with you. We want to have a closer talk with you. Father, we want to live in your presence, and we understand, Lord, that you will not come near to us as long as we are filthy wretched. So, Father, cover us in the blood of Jesus that we might draw near to you and to him. Father, bless right now in the name of Jesus. Bless the visitors that are in our midst, Lord. We ask that you would allow your spirit to flow into the hospitals and convalescent hospitals, the sick beds, Lord, in the prisons, Lord. Wherever there is strife and trouble, we ask that your presence will be there, Father. For we realize when you are near, dark passions subside, Lord. Trouble seems to cease, Father. Good things start happening in our lives, Lord. Lord, because your son took our place on Calvary, Lord. Register!
The Lord is my shepherd.
Yes.
I have all that I need.
He has me rest in green meadows. He leads me beside peaceful streams.
He renews my strength. He guides me along right paths, bringing honor to his name.
Even when I walk through the darkest valley, I will not be afraid, for you are close beside me. Your rod and your staff protect and comfort me.
You prepare a feast for me in the presence of my enemies. You honor me by anointing my head with oil. My cup overflows with blessings altogether.
Surely your goodness and unfailing love will pursue me all the days of my life, and I will live in the house of the Lord forever.
From all that dwells, the Lord is with me.
Thank you.
Thank you. in your name, God, to share a word with your people. Jesus, we need to hear from you. Would you take this broken vessel and just use me? Hide me behind your cross. Send your anointing. Send your blessing. Jesus, just love your name. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
The Lord is my shepherd. I have all that I need. He lets me rest in green meadows. He leads me beside peaceful streams. Medicine for troubling times. Lexio Divina, the divine word. We are in troubling times.
Yes.
Sometimes they are natural in occurrences, like the wildfires that we've had, like the floods and mudslides that we've had. And when those troubling times come, it affects us all. Or when there are things happening within our atmosphere, such as things that touch your space and mine, that they trouble our spirit. There's some kind of stench in the air that just causes us to feel uncomfortable. Last week we reacted to what we call government-sanctioned child abuse. And we tried not to just complain about it, but do something about it, at least through our own expressions of writing letters to our president and to others, letting them know that we were not happy with what was happening. They had to do with our reaction to troubling times. But there are other things that happen internationally and even locally that can trouble our spirits. Last night, when most of us went to bed, there were 13 persons trapped in a cave in Thailand. And we didn't know what would be happening to them, and we woke up this morning to see that at least 4 have been rescued, and there's still optimism that the others will be rescued. But the fact to have human beings trapped miles underneath the earth, and the whole world watching, troubles all of our souls. But thank God that prayers are being answered, and that many are being saved, and perhaps they all will be saved. But those are general troubles, troubles that impact all of us, and sometimes they lead to teachable moments. But there are other troubling times that are not general, they are personal. That there's something within your space, within your family, within your life that affects you. And when they affect you, they are troubling just as much as general kinds of trouble. And what do you do when it's your health, your job, your business, your family, your situation? What do you do when it's personal? You can't write a letter. You can't go to your congressperson. You have to find another way of addressing those troubling situations. That's why we will look at an issue about prescription for troubling times. First, we need to know that none of us will ever be exempt from those troubles.
That's right.
Whether you're a saint or a sinner, whether you're old or you're young,
right.
It doesn't matter what political party, doesn't matter what side of the street you grew up on,
right.
Just live long enough,
right.
And trouble will come your way.
Yes.
And when it comes your way, what will you do?
Yes.
We need to wrestle with that this morning. For me, it became personal this week. When I answered my door and trouble had all its bags packed and wanted to move into my house. It had to do in part with people that I know, families that I've been close to, that have found tragedy facing them.
Yes.
Just this week, or in the last 10 days, a total of 4 deaths.
Yes.
Some of families I knew, some of the persons that I knew.
Yes.
But then there was one in particular just a week ago. A good friend of mine was murdered in front of this house. He had 4 kids. He was a peacemaker in the neighborhood. Yet somehow trouble had found him and taken his life. And when that news came to me, it just sort of flooded over and just caused me just to tremble. God, why him? Why now? Why all of these folks? Why now? Why the sicknesses? Why the deaths? Troubling time. And as I laid before God, taking my petition, God reminded me I had been there before. And that I needed to go and reach for that prescription that I had used before. Because there's some things that God has provided for each of us that if we use them, will help us through troubling times. And part of this prescription has a formal name, Lectio Divina, but it's not necessary to understand the Latin, but to understand the application.
Right.
And the application becomes with beginning with the Word of God. The Word of God. Somewhere in the 66 books of the Bible, there are passages and words that speak to your situation. Every one of us has a different kind of favorite scripture. Favorite verse. Favorite saying that when you read them, they say something to you. Well, part of the prescription for trying to deal with troubling times is to go back to that old landmark. Go back to that scripture and read it again. But not just read it now for information, but read it for inspiration. Lectio Divina in part tells us that first we have to engage the Word of God. And we engage it in a different way. We just don't read it to read it. We read it to begin to experience it. It's like, if any of you are connoisseurs of fine wine, not all of us are, not all of us old enough to yet. But if you are, one of the things they tell you is that you pour the wine slowly into a wide mouth glass. And then you roll it around in the glass. And to smell the aroma of the wine. And then you slowly sip it. And you let it roll around in the glass. And then you experience it. Then you swallow it. You don't throw it down. You let it slowly address your mouth. With the Word of God, it's the same way, but even more importantly, you don't just rush through it. You slowly savor it. And with this scripture, whatever it is, and for me it's the 23rd Psalm, but whatever it is for you, you first read it. And then you read it again, more slowly. And then you read it a third time, even slower. And you read it a fourth time, even slower. Each time, you're trying to sense what it is that God is saying in those words. Just the plain understanding of those words. In which you're trying to understand, what does God say at that moment to me?
Yes.
And as you read it, each time more slowly. Each time you'll find a different kind of reflection of what is in that word. And you begin asking yourself the question, God, what does this mean for me?
Yes.
That's the first reading of the Lectio Divina. The second is to meditate on that word. You want to ask yourself the question, what is the text saying to me today in my life in this situation? The Lord is my shepherd. I have everything that I need. reading it now more slowly, you begin then imagining yourself in that passage, imagining yourself in that verse. You begin using your sanctified imagination to take that word and begin to embrace you, and you begin to meditate on it. You begin visualizing it. You begin imagining it. You begin having it to become part of you.
Yes, Lord.
This week, I was at a hospital visiting one of our members, and I was reading this passage, the 23rd Psalm. And as I was reading it to our member, I was also playing some music that had taken this particular passage to music. And as I began reading it and as the music began to flow, it just happened that on the monitor in her room was something they call healing visions. They were just scenes of peace, of quiet, of nature, of things that began to make me so feel so good. And that was at that moment that God revealed to me, that's what I'm talking about, that when you begin to meditate on my word, when you begin to imagine yourself in my word, you begin to find a peace that surpasses all understanding.
Yes.
And in the midst of your trouble, it doesn't matter whether it's your family or your finances or whatever the personal thing is you can leave your own pity party and instead listen to God and put yourself inside God's words, all of a sudden things begin to change. And one of the side effects, sometimes you take a prescription, now, you know that there are side effects.
Right.
No, what are the side effects when you do this? Is that you fall asleep. It gets so peaceful.
Yeah.
You read it time and time again. And the next thing you know. But that's okay. Because that means you have found yourself in the presence of God. You found yourself in the peace of God. And what a few moments ago when you were going crazy, all of a sudden you have found that peace. So don't get embarrassed if you fall asleep. Just when you wake up, resume the prescription. So you read it, you imagine it, you encounter it, and then the third step is you then pray to God about it and about you and about your situation. After having read God's word and meditated on God's word, you're then in a position to have a conversation with God.
Okay.
And that conversation is not about your ordinary prayers. This is a prayer that's in the will of God. You're praying informed on what you've already meditated on, what you've already read, and you begin just asking God, what do you want me to do?
Right.
Well, what is it that you're saying to me in this situation? Our prayer is no longer really a selfish prayer. Our prayer is a prayer that one that allows us to both speak very seriously to God, but also then to hear from God. Sometimes in our own situation, we find ourselves wrestling with the death of a friend or a family member or the loss of something very important. But you're praying to God and say, God, what are you trying to say to me now? And what will happen in this time is that God responds to prayers like this, and God will respond maybe in a word, sometimes in a picture, sometimes in a name, sometimes in a notion, but God will speak to you and give you an understanding that you didn't have before. And maybe what God will say to you, it was time. She's been sick so long. I want to bring her home. Or you have another situation that's better than the one that you're about to leave. And you just got to let go.
All right.
Or whatever the circumstances are, God will speak to you in your idiom, in your situation, and all you have to do is just listen to God. Because God is saying, I got you, child.
Some pain.
Yes.
But you're in the right place. We can do it.
Now, as I sing our hymn of invitation, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. The Lectio Divina was something that was first practiced by the Benedictine monks about 800 AD. So for about the last 1,200 years, there have been those who have said, I've decided to follow Jesus, and use this particular formulation to follow him. And when you follow him, you'll discover there is no turning back. No turning back.
Amen.
Shall we sing together?
Yeah.
Let us pray. God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for showing us the path of troubling situations. We ask that you hear the prayers of those that have come to the altar and those that have prayed from their seats. Give us the strength to walk in your word, to walk in your will, so that we might be blessings to others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We like to acknowledge our visitors that are here. If you're here for the first time or we haven't seen you in a while, would you please stand? We'd like to just have you introduce yourself to the congregation. Rick and Robin will come and then your microphone. You don't have to sing a solo, you just let us know your name. Whatever you're from, if we have any friends or family.
My name is Rick Wilson. This is my wife, Annie Wilson. I've been here before. This is my wife's first visit. We're members of Christ our Redeemer Church in Irvine.
Yes.
Reverend Mark. From Mark
Law. Yes. God bless you. Thank you so very much.
She comes from Italy. We're both Italian, but I live here in the United States. This is her first visit to the United States. And she heard about the spirit in this church and wanted to experience it. We are both Roman Catholic and belong to Our Lady's Assumption in Natura. And this is my second visit because my friend Sharon, I was here witnessing her wedding.
Yes.
And this is my second visit.
Thank you. We are not
going to do this. Thank you.
My name is Richard Hook. I'm a Episcopalian. Normally I go to St. Andrew's Episcopal Church in Ohio. The reason I wanted to come to church today is
West Point graduate, that's in 1982, and just this month, West Point appointed its first black superintendent. It's the first black superintendent they had since the academy was formed 260 years ago. So I thought that was very important to celebrate. So thank you for allowing me to be here to share that with you. Thank you.
How are you guys doing this morning?
We're doing great.
I'm here with my family, my father-in-law, Ronald Greenwood.
Amen.
And my mother-in-law, Teresa Greenwood.
Amen.
My beautiful wife.
Yes.
Amaya Greenwood, or Amaya Silva.
That's what they're ready.
And this is our son, Josiah Spillman. We're from Katy, Texas. Just coming here to fellowship with you guys. And we're here to actually pick up on Sunday evening with Grandma and Papa.
Ron.
I guess I should say I'm glad that we're able to come and we visited the church before, but we haven't been here in a couple of years, I think. So nice to be back.
One upstairs? Oliver says there's one upstairs. Oh, one more downstairs. Oh.
Good morning, everybody. I'm Teresa Boyzo. I'm a member here at Bethel. And I haven't seen you in 3 weeks, but I'm doing fine. And just like Pastor was saying a little while ago, just that phone call that you get from the brothers and sisters, that they're thinking about you. I just wanted to thank you for thinking of me and that you are my family and that you care. And just wanted to get up and say thank you so much for those calls and God bless you all and have an awesome day.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Isaiah Nichols. I come to him from San Jose State University.
Amen.
My father is older. It's always a good time coming back down and coming to my hometown church. And I'm blessed to be here.
Amen.
Congratulations on your good work at San Jose. Well, to all of our visitors, you are welcome. We're glad to have you here. You are a blessing to us. And we pray that you've been blessed by participating in worship with us today. And you're invited to come back again and again and again. You don't have to stand up the next time. He's a part of our family now. Amen.
Amen.
Quickly, your bulletin has a lot of information and a lot of activities going on. We want to just call your attention to them. Please read the bulletin.
Amen.
Please read the bulletin. It's there for all of us to follow. Amen.
Amen. Amen.